Hello, everyone, and welcome. It's really a very exciting day. Thank you so much for joining us today at the opening celebration of Wellesley's new science complex. My name is Megan Nunez, and I am the Nan Walsh Shao Class of 54 and Howard B. Shao Professor of the Physical and Natural Sciences, Professor of Chemistry, and the Dean of Faculty Affairs. I want to welcome everyone who's here in the room and those who are joining us remotely, whether from elsewhere in the building or around the world. To begin with, we're going to start with a short video about inclusive STEM education at Wellesley.
No matter the environment, like, I can do this material, I can learn it, and I can also contribute to it.
I went through Wellesley really sort of believing I could do anything.
In order to solve and put the full power of science to work, you need to have a full slate and a diverse slate of individuals making those decisions, and women have to be there.
We're at a moment in our history where discovery across fields, across disciplines, is unparalleled. And Wellesley should be and is at the center of that discovery. We produce the largest number of women PhDs in science and engineering compared to any of our liberal arts peers. And when we look at our graduates, they are doing everything from being space shuttle commanders to leaders in technology to scientists across academia and to some of the leading medical scientists in the country.
I never questioned my value when I was at Wellesley. You know, I certainly had moments of despair when I couldn't figure something out or I failed a test. But I never questioned my value as a scientist or a wannabe scientist. I was a graduate student at MIT, and it was a tough place. This was in the 1990s, and there were not a lot of women, and women in general didn't feel like they belonged. And some of my goals as an educator is to change that, is to really make space for all voices to be heard, because that's the only way that we can access everyone's ideas, right? There's no point bringing in people with really good ideas into our organizations and then silencing them.
Our students not only become scientists, they become confident scientists and other leaders in STEM fields. And as they progress in their careers, it's not only about their success, but they bring others behind them.
Interestingly, I also worked in the computing labs, and the faculty staff helped us to, as part of my work study job. And that's really how I got into tech. So it's funny how, like, these worlds all came together. I spent a lot of time in the computing labs and in the science center. And I certainly had a number of science classes in biology and chemistry. And it's just, I'm so glad for all of those experiences because they've really sort of forged who I am today.
We've made great progress over the last 50 years in getting women into STEM fields. But there's still a lot of work to be done to continue to get young women, particularly young women of color, into the pipeline.
I'm very excited about what Wellesley's doing here, and I actually think the Science Center is a manifestation of this too in so many ways. Today, Wellesley's investing in making sure that all students know where their support networks are, how can they understand people who are coming in from different backgrounds, and actually bring them along.
I would like to see more people who look like me in this field. It's also really good for retention. If you can find mentors who look like you, who understand you, that's incredibly important for just keeping the field diverse. Something I think that's really cool about Wellesley is they have a lot of programs that will get you exposed to research. Whether in my first year we had like the first year apprenticeship program where it was literally me being put into a lab to shadow what was already happening there, which is a really approachable way of getting into research.
You know, we're doing real science, right? We're doing science that's relevant, that's getting published in, you know, major peer-reviewed journals, and it's done by students like Lizette, right? And I think it can be surprising to folks, like the caliber that you can engage students in.
In the future, I'd love to teach, and I'd love that to involve communicating science in a way that is just inclusive of all people's backgrounds.
STEM needs you. STEM needs young women of all backgrounds. The science complex is really a bold invitation for our students and our faculty to come together to learn, to invent, and to create in ways that I think will be unparalleled.
And now I would like to invite Wellesley President Paula Johnson to the podium. President Johnson needs no introduction, but she's getting one anyway, whether she likes it or not. So among the Wellesley community, we know her well, but for the benefit of our guests, since joining Wellesley in 2016, she has put the college at the forefront of STEM education for women and has led the creation of a bold new strategic plan that places inclusive excellence at the heart of a Wellesley education. As a physician scientist, President Johnson has improved health outcomes for women around the globe by revealing and addressing gender biases in both clinical care and medical research. The founder of the Connors Center for Women's Health and Gender Biology at Brigham and Women's Hospital, she shifted paradigms by recognizing that disease presentation is often influenced by sex, a biological factor, as it intersects with the social determinants of health. A cardiologist, President Johnson was also the Grace A. Young Family Professor of Medicine in Women's Health at the Harvard Medical School, as well as Professor of Epidemiology at the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. So please join me in welcoming Wellesley's 14th president, Paula Johnson.
Thank you, Megan. Well, welcome. Welcome to everyone. It is so wonderful to see all of you here as we celebrate the opening of our new science complex. This is such an important addition to our campus, and it's truly a remarkable opportunity for Wellesley College. And it's an example of the power of STEM education as an essential component of a liberal arts education. What we are doing here at Wellesley is not only important for our students, but also for science and technology in the United States and around the world. Although we've made progress, as you heard in the video, the U.S. hasn't really truly been quite adept at bringing women, especially women of color, into many STEM fields. That failure to inspire a pipeline of young women costs the nation in so many ways, because who you are influences what you see. We need the talents of women in all STEM fields if we are going to make progress on the many puzzles and challenges of our world. At Wellesley, we've been diversifying the sciences since 1875, since we opened the doors. Wellesley's founders, Pauline and Henry Durant, insisted that laboratory instruction should be part of a curriculum for all Wellesley students. That was highly unusual in that time. Not surprisingly, Wellesley led the way in science education, establishing one of the country's first undergraduate physics labs and one of the first biochemistry programs at a liberal arts college, and building an unusually sophisticated on-campus observatory for our astronomy department in the year 1900. It's no accident that our first black graduate, the indomitable Harriet Elaine Rice, class of 1887, went on to medical school after Wellesley. She had an amazing and varied career as a physician, including spending 3 years caring for French soldiers on the front lines of World War I, at a time when no American hospital would allow a black woman to practice. Today, 5 of our 7 most popular majors are in STEM, and 80% of our STEM graduates attend graduate or professional school within 10 years of graduation. And this really makes Wellesley a top national producer of women who earn advanced degrees in STEM. Our success is in large part due, of course, to our brilliant students, but to our brilliant and committed faculty, who top the list of faculty at liberal arts colleges without graduate programs in terms of the federal dollars of support that they raise for their research. We're also a force for racial and ethnic diversity in the sciences. Over the past 10 years, we've doubled the percentage of STEM degrees awarded to underrepresented minorities. However, we are also keenly aware that if Wellesley College is going to achieve its fundamental goal of inclusive excellence, that we have to expand opportunities for our students to learn science and to participate in hands-on research. So we've made this critical investment in our science complex, the largest and most significant capital project ever undertaken by the college, which includes a new state-of-the-art research, innovation, and teaching building, with the classrooms, research facilities, and collaborative spaces to support world-class teaching and learning. Our faculty will be able to carry out their cutting-edge research in these new facilities that will allow for unprecedented collaboration across disciplines. All of this while deeply engaging our students in the work that they do. Our ability to recruit the most promising young faculty will absolutely be enhanced, which is absolutely central to our future. With this complex, we'll be able to bring even more Wellesley students from all backgrounds into the culture of science, teaching them that they belong here. The students who will be educated at the science complex are going to make important contributions to our knowledge and technology-dependent local and national economy, to innovations that improve lives, to medical advances in public health, and to our fundamental understanding of the universe. So I am so proud that we are able to offer these future leaders facilities commensurate with their talents and with their potential. And now it's my pleasure to introduce a great champion of STEM education, Lieutenant Governor Karyn Polito. Throughout her distinguished career in public service, Lieutenant Governor Polito has been a powerful advocate, not only for STEM, but for prioritizing the inclusion of more women and people of color in the STEM pipeline, so that STEM leadership can be as diverse as the many people who make up the state of Massachusetts. Since being sworn in as the 72nd Lieutenant Governor of the Commonwealth in 2015, she has made it one of her key priorities to build a diverse STEM workforce across the Commonwealth, and has done so much to strengthen Wellesley's reputation, Massachusetts reputation. little slip, kind of one and the same, but anyway, so much to strengthen Massachusetts' reputation as a worldwide leader in STEM. In doing so, she enhanced Massachusetts' already impressive reputation as a magnet for the country and the world's top scientists. She has strengthened the Commonwealth's economy and brought some of the most exciting and most innovative leaders across industries to Massachusetts to solve some of the most pressing problems facing our society and planet. One of the key ways she has contributed to this effort is as co-chair of the STEM Advisory Council, where she has encouraged further opportunities in STEM education to inspire more students to get involved in these important fields and better connect them to fulfilling careers. Just as impressive as Lieutenant Governor Polito's commitment to STEM is her commitment to bipartisan, results-driven leadership and to serving as a leader for all residents of the Commonwealth. Since taking the office with Governor Charlie Baker, Lieutenant Governor Polito has visited and partnered with leadership in all 351 of the Commonwealth's cities and towns, signing community compact agreements with every municipality on more than 800 smarter ways to deliver services. I could go on and on, but as you can see, she has made a positive impact on Massachusetts in so many ways, and I am thrilled that she is here with us today. And I'd like to welcome Lieutenant Governor Polito to the podium.
Good afternoon. Thank you for that beautiful introduction. I am indeed here at Wellesley to promote everything that you're doing around STEM and certainly to spotlight this incredible STEM center with all of you today here, with your students, your faculty, and for those who are joining this program virtually from places around the world. It's indeed a very exciting moment for all of you here at Wellesley. It's indeed a wonderful moment here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts and for future women leaders who will be graduating and continue to graduate for many years to come from this fine institution. So it's an honor and a pleasure to be with you, President Johnson. Reshma, we are going to hear from you with your keynote remarks, and soon you'll hear from a panel of experts and women leaders who will continue to inspire all of us around the subject, including Congressman Auchincloss, who will be joining us and is one of my co-chairs to the STEM Advisory Council, along with Jeffrey Lydon of Vertex, who has been an incredible leader for all things STEM, not only for his organization, which he loves dearly, but also for children of this Commonwealth to pursue subjects involving STEM and to engage in learning that will engage them in future jobs and careers that are important for our economy, important for solving global challenges, and important for the individual's opportunity for meaningful job, career, and experience. So it is with pleasure I come here. Yes, as a 72nd Lieutenant Governor, I happen to be the fourth woman to hold this position. We have a long way to go in government to do more in leadership, and I think we're on a pathway to doing more of that in Massachusetts. But I love this, leading the wave for women in STEM. And I think, Reshma, we talked earlier, female future, right, is our future female, and being very intentional around having women in places, your voices matter, your voices as experts in your field, your voices as women who are balancing career and family, women who want to see themselves in places and breaking down barriers and climbing the ladder of what you do a whole lot of here and helping women feel that confidence to put themselves into maybe uncomfortable situations so that they can continue to strive and thrive. So let me just talk a little bit about why this is important. I have been one of the lead voices for STEM education in the Commonwealth. And I do this because it's important, yes, for the future success in a very competitive global economy and success for Massachusetts. But I do this because I want to see more people have access to opportunity. Now, when you think about Massachusetts and our innovation economy, which we know well, and it's been on display in multiple ways, particularly when battling through COVID, you could see the exemplary skills and abilities that we have, including a medical advisory board that helped to advise Governor Baker, grounding our decisions on science and data all the way through a most uncertain time to help us make decisions, communicate to the public, and come through as successfully as possible. But we are in an economy that requires people to have specific skills, but also specific abilities around collaboration, teamwork, thinking and solving problems, using state-of-the-art and cutting-edge ideas and methods to unlock solutions to world challenges, whether it's battling through a global health pandemic, solving food insecurity, of which you are going to do a whole lot of here at Wellesley with this incredible center, you know, coming up with the solutions for climate and energy that are going to be impactful for many, many years to come. But that requires everyone to be intentional and to take responsibility for it, which is my first message of thanks to this institution for taking on the responsibility of engaging women in the discussion about their role in solving these problems that we know of today and inevitably the problems that we don't know about that will be on us. So thank you for taking that responsibility so seriously and being intentional about it. This STEM Center is an intentional decision for this institution to make significant contributions to having an incredible environment here in a complex of buildings and spaces that incorporate the most incredible equipment and minds in terms of your faculty to put young women into places where they can start to contemplate their future. Now, in Massachusetts, and this is just an example, it probably represents a lot of other places in this country and around the world, 76% of our STEM workforce is white, okay? We have strong representation of women, about half, in some areas of STEM, but not so much in engineering and computer science. The life sciences and healthcare, yes, but not so much in other disciplines. We have so much work to do. And we know that you have to be intentional because gender disparities begin to manifest in women in their middle school ages and certainly exacerbate in high school and then further exacerbate in a college setting. You have to start young, especially for girls to see themselves in STEM, which is one of the themes that we've incorporated into our STEM Council and our work in the Baker Polito administration. Starting early in K through 12 education for students of color and young girls to see themselves in careers and in jobs that they might not have an immediate example in their family for, but to see themselves on these pathways. And we've also created what are called innovation career pathways in the subject areas that are part of our innovation economy, starting in eighth grade and then helping girls and boys and underrepresented minorities to start to engage in the subject matter, right eighth grade, ninth grade, and continue forward. We've also looked to break down barriers of access to higher learning through early college, where students can start to earn their credits for college in high school. And then we've incorporated STEM Starter Academies in all 15 of our community colleges, which is an access point that's more affordable for individuals, and they can then transfer the community college credits directly to any one of our four-year colleges and universities, public colleges and universities in Massachusetts, and gain a further degree, even partnering with institutions like WPI, and I would love to see us partner with Wellesley to do even more to extend those opportunities for students within our K through 12 education systems across our Commonwealth. And so these are just examples about how we've been intentional, including investing about $150 million into classrooms, to transform classrooms and learning places and help educators and teachers think differently about hands-on experiential learning. And so you'll see in our classrooms now CNC machines, 3D printers, the kinds of scopes and things in a laboratory in our classrooms so that kids get excited and that spark of interest begins early on in their educational experience. And so we've challenged our employer community as well, and the theme that we incorporate there is inspire a STEM start. You as an employer must be intentional about how you recruit and retain your talent. Every employer is struggling for this, of course, to diversify their workplaces and get more women engaged in their workplaces and in leadership positions. So we say, open up your workplace virtually for a tour. Open it up in person, like Vertex has done. You know, invest in our paid high school internship program, of which we are going to reach the mark of 10,000, and we'll be announcing that during STEM Week, which is starting October 17th in just a short period of time from now. And so inspiring employers to be an extension and a critical partner to STEM education, which is, I know, something that you're doing a lot more of here at Wellesley. Wellesley, to many, is thought of as a liberal arts college. And while it is also equally a STEM college. And that's the story we want to see broadcasted and amplified even more so out of your launch today and out of the experiences that women are having as graduates and alum of this incredible institution to tell their stories of success from their workplaces and continue to always be active alum and partners to inspire more women to engage in these pathways to STEM careers so that they too can be at that table making decisions and in that laboratory making discoveries that will unlock the solutions to make lives better and healthier and to make our environment and world a happier and healthier and better place to be for all. So I want to thank you for inviting me just to have a few minutes with you, just to say thank you for your incredible partnership and being a part of our Massachusetts success story, where we blaze trails, we put ourselves on the leading and cutting edge of the line. And we couldn't do that without having incredible partners like you. President Johnson and your team, congratulations, and many years of success in this beautiful STEM center. Congratulations.
Thank you so much, Lieutenant Governor, and thank you for all that you do. And we will look forward to continuing that work and even making it greater, so thank you. So now I'd like to introduce Dr. Reshma Kewalramani. Dr. Kewalramani has dedicated her career to improving the lives of patients, both as a physician and as a leader in the biotechnology industry, where she has spent the past 18 years helping to lead the development of new medicines. Dr. Kewalramani joined Vertex in 2017 in collaboration with the Executive Committee, Board of Directors, the entire Vertex community. She currently leads and executes the company's strategy and ambitious mission of transforming the lives of people with serious diseases. Prior to taking on her role as CEO and president, she was the chief medical officer and executive vice president of global medicines, development, and medical affairs at Vertex. Dr. Kewalramani earned her medical degree with honors from the seven-year medicine program at Boston University's School of Medicine and completed the general management program at Harvard Business School. She completed her internship and residency in internal medicine at Massachusetts General Hospital and her fellowship in nephrology through the MGH and Brigham and Women's Hospital combined program. In addition to improving the lives of patients and accessibility to cutting-edge medicines through her work at Vertex, Dr. Kewalramani is passionate about developing and supporting the next generation of scientists and giving back to her community. She currently serves as a member of the Board of Directors of the Biomedical Sciences Careers Program, an organization dedicated to supporting underrepresented students to pursue a career in STEM, and is also a member of the Boston University School of Medicine's Dean's Advisory Board and the MGH Board of Trustees and the Ginkgo Bioworks Board of Directors. She is a fellow of the American Society of Nephrology, and she was the inaugural, on the inaugural board of the directors of the Kidney Health Initiative. Dr. Kewalramani is the recipient of the Harvard Medical School Excellence in Teaching Award, and in 2019, she received the TAI Boston Healthcare Leadership Award and was named one of Boston Business Journal's Power 50. She's probably one of the Power 5. Under her leadership as CEO, Vertex was ranked number 2 on the Commonwealth Institute's top women-led businesses in Massachusetts in 2021. Dr. Kewalramani is one of the biotechnology's industry's most accomplished executives and a powerful example to so many of our students of the roles that one can pursue in science and medicine to make a difference in the lives of others. She also models for us visionary and inclusive leadership. So I am so thrilled that she is here with us today to discuss her path through medicine and the importance of making STEM and STEM leadership more inclusive. Welcome.
Dr. Johnson has a way of making anyone sound really good. I wish she tells all this stuff to my 2 children, and I might get some respect in the household. Dr. Johnson, thank you for such a warm welcome. Thank you also to Lieutenant Governor Polito and to all of you, staff, faculty, and especially the students for being here today. I'm told that we also have representatives here from many of the Boston area companies. To all of you, I have a special message. If you're trying to recruit Wellesley grads to your internships and jobs, get in line. I'm joking a little, but in all seriousness, it's always great to be here on the Wellesley College campus. I live literally around the corner, and I've taken countless walks along the winding paths of your beautiful campus. Today, it's an honor. It's a true honor to help you celebrate this momentous occasion. The new science complex, I'm told, is the most significant construction project undertaken on Wellesley's campus in over 100 years. A project 6 years in the making. This new building is a tribute to your future, and I might say to all of our futures. The future of Wellesley, of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and the students is incredibly bright. It always was, but now you have this beautiful building in which you can make discoveries, inventions, and do so much for the future. It's hard to think of a time that's more appropriate to talk about STEM and our society than right here and right now. In the lifetime of today's Wellesley student, the speed of innovation has increased exponentially. In medicine, in technology, in data sciences, things are moving faster than any prior point in history. Let me give you some examples. In the 1960s, scientists took about 4 years to develop the mumps vaccine. That was the fastest development for a widely used vaccine in history. That is, until 2020, when the development of the COVID vaccine shattered all records. It was developed in about 1 year, and it was done right here in Massachusetts. This is one example of the rapid pace of innovation today. But advancements in robotics, in computing power, in medicine, have many more examples to provide. Indeed, human adoption of these technologies has also accelerated. It took 30 years, and 25, keep this in mind, 30 years and 25 years for the telephone and for electricity to reach about 10% adoption. It took more than 50 years for the telephone, a landline, to achieve about 40% adoption. That same metric of 40% adoption, that was achieved in about 5 years for the smartphone. Out of necessity, during the height of the COVID pandemic, tens of millions, if not hundreds of millions of people adapted to remote work. And while imperfect, that societal shift happened within months, a speed that would have been unimaginable a few years ago and certainly a few decades ago. Accelerated innovation has vast implications, but one rings particularly clear for me. Our world today, as you've heard from others, demands that everyone engage in science, technology, engineering, and medicine. That's true whether you seek a career in STEM or whether you simply want to be an active member of our democracy. In short, the future has arrived. And we must all be STEM majors, so to speak. And in order to maximize the potential and to maximize the potential of our collective future, we all have an urgent responsibility to make this field one in which all people feel welcomed and can thrive. And to be honest, that has not always been the case. Challenges in STEM are complex, multidimensional, and often without obvious solutions. Landing a shuttle on the moon, curing cancer, establishing clean sources of energy. The list goes on and on. To tackle these problems, we need a diverse, passionate, and well-educated talent base, and we need investment. In front of me and standing here in this building, I see both in spades. Within my own lifetime, and I'm not that old, I've seen how much technological change is possible. Going back to telephones, in the 1970s, I was born and raised in Bombay, and in my apartment building, one landline served 15 plus households. Today, in India, cell phones are ubiquitous. Everyone from business executives to the roadside vendors to the rickshaw driver has a cell phone. And truth be told, today, when I'm in Mumbai, I have better cellular service than when I am around the corner at my home in Wellesley. Most closely, I've watched accelerated innovation shape medicine. I entered college in 1990. I graduated from medical school in 1998. And I finished my training in the early 2000s. In the years that have followed, advances in medicine and technology have transformed healthcare. Let me give you three examples I know well because of my work in Boston and my work at Vertex. In 2012, Jennifer Doudna and Emmanuelle Charpentier, two women scientists, published their seminal paper describing their pioneering work in CRISPR gene editing. Charpentier co-founded a company called CRISPR Therapeutics right here in Massachusetts. A few years later, Vertex partnered with CRISPR with the goal of developing a curative therapy for two related diseases, sickle cell disease and beta thalassemia, diseases that have to do with red blood cells. In 2020, the two women won the Nobel Prize. That same year, in 2020, in the New England Journal of Medicine, we published the first report of the first patients treated with CRISPR-Cas9 for sickle cell disease and beta thalassemia. And here we are in 2022, a mere decade, and in drug development, that's like 10 seconds. Here we are on the precipice of bringing this potentially transformative medicine to patients who are waiting. Here's another example. About 10 years ago, scientists at the Boston Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center found that two mutations in a particular gene called APOL1 led to a very aggressive form of kidney disease. This particular genetically driven kidney disease was not even known when I finished my training in the early 2000s, and I may not have told you, but I'm a kidney doctor. Last year, a little over a decade later, Vertex completed early stage clinical studies of a medicine targeting this disease and demonstrated in these early clinical trials remarkable results. That medicine is now in pivotal development, hopefully ready to bring something to patients in the coming years. And finally, let me talk about type 1 diabetes. Okay, 1921. In 1921, Banting, a surgeon, and Charles Best, his medical student, at the University of Toronto, discovered insulin. Insulin is an amazing drug, an absolutely amazing drug. It allows type 1 patients, without exaggeration, to live. However, it is not a cure. Here's an outlandish idea. Here is what we want to do. How about we grow pancreatic islet cells in a laboratory, give them, these pancreatic islet cells grown in the laboratory, to patients with type 1 diabetes, and strive for a cure? You know what? It's already been done. Early stage trials with laboratory-made stem cells that are these insulin-producing cells were conducted, and 100 years after the discovery of insulin, so the discovery of insulin is 1921, in 2021, we released results from the first few patients who have had this treatment. In other words, we are at a point now where regenerative medicine may be possible. When you think about the conventional timescale of drug discovery and development, these are truly remarkable examples of the acceleration of innovation. This is not sci-fi. This is not what we imagine could happen in the future. This is happening right now. The vast changes I witnessed in my life are not limited to science. When my family immigrated to the United States in the early 1980s, I was the only Indian student in my elementary school, exit 49 North, Huntington, Long Island. Having been raised in a traditional Indian family, the disproportionate pride my grandparents held for my brother, the son of their only son, was clear. At the time I graduated high school in 1990, there were three women on the Fortune 500 list of CEOs, and the first female person of color was yet to be named CEO. The idea that a woman, especially someone of color like myself, would become CEO of a publicly traded US company was not a mainstream idea. And yet, in 2020, I became the first female CEO of a large biotech company. And it happened right here in Massachusetts. Now, I'm committed to helping others because I believe our society's future depends on our collective will to do so. My 5 years at Vertex have only demonstrated further how diversity of thought and experience is not merely an ideal, but a necessity to foster an innovative, open, and successful workplace and society. But as you've heard from Dr. Johnson, we're falling short. We've known for some time that boys and girls start equally interested in math and science. Often in elementary schools, girls outperform boys in those subjects. By middle school, the trend reverses. Girls drop off, and boys are disproportionately represented in math and science. A recent study found that as early as sixth grade, girls self-evaluate 13 points lower than their male peers in science and math. The gap persists, if not worsens, into adulthood. In this age of accelerated innovation, dropping out is no longer an option. The speed of progress makes it urgent that we solve the historic problem of gender exclusion. And let me be clear, I don't believe that women are superior to men in math and science. What I do believe is that women are equally capable as men, and their absence from the fields that dictate the workings of our society that will become even more prominent in the future comes at an increasingly high and unacceptable cost. We all share this responsibility to reverse the status quo. The absence of diversity will undermine technology, medicine, and our society. People often talk about the costs of lacking diversity, and I'm just going to talk about a couple of examples that really drive this home. In 2018, and I'm going to be careful in how I pronounce the name because I want to get it right so that if you want to look it up, you can. In 2018, Joy Bualawini and Timnit Gebru co-authored a groundbreaking paper which found that widely used facial analysis systems disproportionately fail to identify the face, the actual face, of people of color, especially women of color, when compared to the ability of these technologies to identify the face of white men. Think about that. Think about the implications. When facial recognition technology is used from everything to unlock your iPhone to law enforcement. In medicine, similar costs of skewed or lacking representation can be fatal. I'm thinking about the measurable absence of people of Asian descent, for example, in clinical trials. We know that people of different ethnicities can have different metabolism. We may need different doses of our medicines for safety or efficacy. Yet, despite the fact that in the United States, Asians make up about 6% of the population, they make up about 1% of clinical trial enrollment. When researchers learn less about the illness in women and people of color, their healthcare suffers. Studies have shown that patients of color are far less likely to be believed that they are in pain. Think about sickle cell disease. Or receive pain medicines than white patients. Women presenting with crushing chest pain, the absolute epitome of what should make a physician or a healthcare provider think about a heart attack, women are far less likely to be diagnosed with that heart attack. Women are more likely to be misdiagnosed or their condition entirely overlooked following a stroke. Along with many Wellesley students, staff, and faculty, it is actually President Johnson who has highlighted and brought much of this to light. And I would be hard-pressed to imagine an audience more committed to closing the inequality and inequity gap. And the fact is, we have made progress. So the question before us is, how do we make more tangible progress, and how do we get to the finish line? Here's what I think. We must introduce young girls, as Lieutenant Governor Polito explained, to STEM early and often, We must remove barriers to their continued participation in STEM, in classes, in opportunities, in clubs, in internships, in majors, and in jobs. We must increase broad science literacy at every level and stage, including in the workforce and in adult education. And that brings me to this science complex, a significant step forward in our shared goal to establish gender parity in STEM. You've heard some of the stats, but I want to tell you how I think about this center and the stats that stay in my mind. This science complex is a triumph that boasts 100,000 square feet of new space, 36 classrooms, 108 labs, 158 offices for staff and student. Yet, what makes this space special is Wellesley's proven effort to increase the number of women in STEM. We know that women are much more likely to major in STEM at a women's college than a co-ed college. Wellesley is the only liberal arts college to be ranked in the top 50 of all undergraduate institutions based on the number of women graduates who earn PhDs. Wellesley is the only liberal arts college amongst the top 50 to receive funding from the National Science Foundation, and Wellesley's STEM faculty are awarded more federal funding than any other undergraduate-only liberal arts college. And the STEM faculty, more than half, are women. I heard this next stat when I heard Dr. Johnson speak. Over the last decade, Wellesley has doubled the percentage of STEM degrees it awards to underrepresented minority students. The point is, this building is about more than square footage. It represents Wellesley's decades-long effort to make tangible progress. And with this building and with this investment, boy, is the future bright. I was thinking about women scientists that have inspired me and continue to inspire me to this day. And those of you who know me know that my most favorite scientist is Barbara McClintock. So let me tell you about her. I'm sure Wellesley students, Dr. Johnson, are very familiar with Barbara McClintock, but for those of you who may not be, let me tell you about my most favorite scientist. Barbara McClintock enrolled in Cornell. She must not have heard about Wellesley, or I'm sure she would have been here. She enrolled in 1919. She was 17 years old at the time. Genetics was a new discipline, and she took the one class that Cornell offered. It changed her life. She earned her PhD and embarked on a 70-plus year career studying cytogenetics. And the core of what she was studying was maize, corn. And she noticed that there were some traits in these maize, in the corn, that shifted across near generations, a behavior that defied accepted knowledge. She began to come to the conclusion that this was due to, in layman's terms, jumping genes, something that was thought to be impossible at the time. When she delivered a lecture about her work at the prestigious Cold Spring Harbor's annual symposium, she watched as the audience responded. And I quote, she said about that experience, that they saw her as crazy, absolutely mad. Their reaction ended her lecturing and her publishing career. Yet she never abandoned her beliefs. She later said, and I quote, "I just knew I was right." Over a decade later, the world caught up to her. Others started to corroborate her conclusions. She received belated credit for her transformative work in the field. And 30 years after her discovery, she won the Nobel Prize. And now we know that half of our DNA sequences are made up of transposons, or Barbara McClintock's jumping genes. The point of the story and why I like it so much is that nobody else thought like her. Her upbringing, her age, her gender, her approach. In other words, everything that made her different is what enabled her to imagine the possibility of the impossible and led her to discover transposons decades before others caught up. Going from the past to the present, let me share two short stories about two Vertex scientists that I have the pleasure of working with. Felicia Pagliuca, who happens to be here with us, and Cruz Smith, who may also be with us today. Felicia leads a type 1 diabetes program. Remember the cells I told you about that we make in the laboratory that we can give to patients with type 1 diabetes. She worked with Doug Melton in stem cell biology for her postdoc. Their team made the breakthrough that allows this potential therapy to be possible. And she co-founded a company and got venture capital, less than 2% of which goes to women. And she and Doug started the company that Vertex eventually partnered with. And that drug that was her postdoc project, that's the drug in patient trials today. Cruz Smith. Cruz Smith works on sickle cell disease. Cruz grew up in a black community where sickle cell disease is common. She majored in molecular biology, earned her PhD in stem cell biology and hematology, and years later worked in the lab that made the seminal discovery of BCL11A, the very locus that we are using for our stem cell CRISPR-based gene editing program. Crew currently leads a team focused on transforming sickle cell disease at the company. Crew and Felicia's stories are contemporary examples of the power of women in STEM. I get goosebumps when I think of Dr. Barbara McClintock, Dr. Felicia Pagliuca, Dr. Crew Smith. And I get goosebumps when I think about the future discoveries that will be made by Wellesley faculty and Wellesley students right here in this building. With us today, we have President Johnson, a world-class physician, scientist, and educator. I understand that Judy Ann Bigby, the physician and former Massachusetts Secretary of Health and Human Services, is also here. I also understand that Story Landis, the neurobiologist who led the NIH and the Neurological Disorders and Stroke Institute for over a decade, is also here. These women and so many more are part of Wellesley's extraordinary legacy. And that extraordinary legacy is not just the past, but Wellesley's present and future. To the Wellesley faculty, staff, and especially the students here, I'm honored to be here with you. I'm honored to mark the beginning of this new era represented by this building. And I can't wait to see what you do next. Thank you.
Reshma, thank you. That was really so moving. And I do have to share, I am old enough to remember when we couldn't treat sickle cell, and when there was really only pain meds and a lot of despair. And it is just, I remember when that first paper came out in the New England Journal, and it was just such a joy to imagine what has transpired. So thank you. I'm going to ask our panelists to join us in the front, and Representative Auchincloss has just arrived. Well, please take a seat. I'm going to sit here at the end. So I am truly honored to be here with this amazing panel. I want to begin by introducing Representative Jake Auchincloss. Welcome. And Representative Auchincloss is serving his first term in Congress, where he's the vice chair of the Financial Services Committee and a member of the Transportation Infrastructure Committee. His areas of focus include infrastructure, housing, the life sciences, and energy policy. Representative Auchincloss was born just down the street and raised in Newton, Massachusetts, the son of two leaders in academic medicine. In addition to understanding the importance of STEM education at the state and national level, he has a deep understanding of the culture of science and what it will take to make it more inclusive. Thank you so much for taking the time to be with us. Dr. Reshma, can I go by some of the first names?
I think we should.
Except for Representative Auchincloss. Reshma, thank you for that brilliant speech, and you've really set the stage for this discussion. Thank you. Dr. Dana M. Dana is a board-certified emergency physician who served as director of quality and safety in the Department of Emergency Medicine at the Brigham and Women's Hospital and Harvard Medical School. And she leads emergency medicine-related quality improvement and patient safety initiatives at the Brigham, including those involved in the care of patients with behavioral health emergencies. Her leadership through the COVID crisis was critical to the care provided to thousands of patients. We thank you. Dr. M graduated from Wellesley in 2010 with a major in neuroscience and a minor in women and gender studies. And after Wellesley, received a master's of philosophy degree in public health at the University of Cambridge in England. And that was supported by Wellesley's Susan Rappaport Knopfel Class of 52 Scholarship for Foreign Study and the University of Cambridge Overseas Trust Scholarship. She received a joint medical degree and her master's degree in public policy from the Harvard Kennedy School of Government. And as a Gleitzman Fellow at the Center for Public Leadership, you really stood out. She completed her residency training at Mass General and the Brigham, where she served as chief resident during her last year of residency. Welcome, Dana. And last but not least, Dr. Mavalvala Nurgis. Dr. Mavalvala was elected you are the Dean of the School of Science and the Marble Professor of Astrophysics at MIT. She actually earlier introduced herself as just an MIT faculty member. I had to correct that. She graduated from Wellesley in 1990, majoring in physics and astronomy. And while at Wellesley, she worked closely with physics professor Robbie Berg, who probably remembers the day she broke a very expensive laser in his lab. Fortunately, she managed to fix it. She graduated and moved on to graduate school at MIT, where she helped future Nobel laureate Dr. Ray Weiss build a prototype of gravitational wave detector that would become the laser interferometer gravitational wave observatory, or LIGO. She was a postdoc at the California Institute of Technology, and in 2010, her excellence and enormous potential was recognized with the prestigious MacArthur Genius Grant. In 2015, LIGO succeeded in detecting gravitational waves for the first time. And as part of the LIGO team, Professor Mavalvala was awarded the Special Breakthrough Prize in Physics and the Gruber Prize in Cosmology. In 2017, Nurgis was elected to the National Academy of Sciences, and in 2018, Wellesley College honored her with our Alumni Achievement Award. And in 2020, MIT named her the first woman dean of its School of Science. So with this truly incredible panel, I want to start with a question about why. And we've had some of this talked about today, but why is it important to have more women, including women of color, in science and technology? And why isn't that the case now? You know, Reshma, you gave us a wonderful start to really that discussion. So I'm going to turn to Nurgis and ask you to give us your perspective on this.
Well, that's a hard act to follow, right? but I'll try to give you my perspective. But I think what you already told us a lot about is when we bring diverse people into our enterprise, we have diversity of ideas. And some of the problems we're trying to solve are so darn hard that we need every goddamn good idea there is out there. And it comes in every different shape and thought neuron, you know, neurons firing. So that's how, why I think we need it. Now, why aren't we there yet? I think it's because we are in, you know, we live in a society that has pervasive isms in it. There are people out there, whether we know it or not, who do think women are not as good at STEM as men are. There are people who think people of color are not effective at what they do. And so I think we have a lot of very serious work to do ahead of ourselves to break it. And Reshma reminded us, and I'm so grateful you did, we have come a long, long ways, and we have a long, long ways to go.
Can you just tell me a little bit about what you're doing at MIT?
Yeah, so, you know, I think we're doing pretty much, you know, we're following some of the template you've set, Paula, so thank you. But we're basically trying to ask the question of what is it that, you know, what is it that's keeping women and people of color out of our enterprise? How do we bring them in? And more importantly, once we do, how do we ensure that they will belong, they will feel as part of the enterprise and succeed? Yeah. And you know, that requires another really important thing, which is what does success look like? And you know, why do we define it in a certain way and with certain credentials as opposed to other measure. So metrics is a very important part of what we're thinking about when we're thinking about how to be more inclusive in what we do.
Yeah, but, thank you.
But at a very systemic level, we have to think about that.
Yeah. So. And Dana, can you share the why? And I think that Nurgis is talking about metrics, and that is part of what you do as part of your research and what you do day in and day out at the Brigham.
Indeed. So in medicine, you know, our goal really is to provide high quality care to all of our patients, regardless of the color of their skin, their gender, their sexual orientation, or other factors that we, you know, hope that we're blind to, but we really are not. And this is why we need leaders in medicine and also people who are providing care at the bedside to our patients to represent our patients, and especially those who are underrepresented in our community. So, you know, for example, you know, this was brought up earlier, that studies have shown that women who are presenting with chest pain, which could be a symptom of a heart attack, are less likely to be triaged as emergent in the emergency room, and also less likely to get the workup that they need to complete the workup for heart attack. And also, they are likely to wait longer to be seen by a clinician in the emergency room. And these disparities actually perpetuate and also persist for patients of color and also patients with public insurance, which is a marker for other socioeconomic factors. And you know, instead of really sweeping the evidence of health inequities under the rug and ignoring that, we really have to be honest and look inward and really highlight some of these disparities so that we can come up with solutions for the disparities, so that we can provide high quality care to all of our patients. That's why we really need to emphasize diversity and inclusion, so that we can advocate for our patients and also to empower our patients in striving for health equity in healthcare.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Representative Auchincloss, I do want to say it was such a joy having you as our representative, and then the lines got redrawn and we lost you.
You have a few months left, Paula.
We have a few months left. But you know, your leadership has really been so important. And as you think about why is it important to have more women, more
diverse women in science, technology. What drives you in that area?
First of all, thank you for having me, and it's an honor to be on this panel. To me, it's about fairness and it's about talent. I'm in Washington, D.C., and I spend a lot of time thinking about and occasionally having to defend some of the core ideas of our country, one of which is the fact that we really believe that regardless of the circumstances of your birth, you should be able to accomplish anything that you can set your mind to in life, regardless of immutable characteristics of sexual orientation or race or nation of origin or gender, and not letting women have a career pathway in STEM is a failure. It's a failure of that core ideal. And we have made progress, as others have said, and that makes me proud, but we have progress ahead to make. And then it's about talent. We're living in the century of biology. The 19th century was the century of physics, the 20th century, the century of chemistry, the 21st century, I think, is gonna be the century of biology, and we can't have 50% of the population not participating. We need all the smart people we can get, and we're gonna see already that the STEM fields just have a voracious appetite for new and great people, and we've gotta ensure that they have access to as many people as possible. And it's personal for me. You mentioned I grew up in a family of scientists. My mom was a trailblazing female scientist in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. And her career, I think, has mapped the arc of improvement for women in science. She'd be the first to tell you that we've made progress and that we've got more to do. But actually, her dad, my grandfather, Mel Glimcher, was the first Jewish chair of orthopedic surgery at MGH. This was right after World War II. And it's just there just weren't Jews in medicine in Greater Boston. That's changed, obviously. But his colleagues, he was going to be denied that promotion. And his colleagues, many of whom were veterans of World War II, said, we did not go over there and fight to see Jews here at home be excluded from opportunity. And so the broader theme of just inclusion in science is really personally meaningful to me because it's done so much for my family. And I know it's going to do so much for families throughout the country.
Yeah. Thank you. Dana and Nurgis and Reshma, each of you has personally experienced the challenge of entering a field where men have traditionally dominated. I want to now ask you, when did you realize that you might be a barrier breaker? We've been talking a lot about breaking barriers and alumni from Wellesley breaking barriers. But when did you know, and how did you push through? And Nurgis, I'm gonna start with you because you came to Wellesley from Pakistan, and you've had a remarkable journey since then. You know, you studied physics here and then and astronomy and then went on to graduate study. When did you first realize you were a barrier breaker?
So there is actually a moment. So I was an undergraduate here at Wellesley, and I went for my junior year abroad on the Wellesley's study abroad program to Germany. So I was a student of German. And I had this moment. So here at Wellesley, I was a student of physics and astronomy, and everybody in my classes were my fellow Wellesley women. I walked into my first physics lecture at my German university, at the University of Konstanz. It was a room maybe about four times the size. There were more than 100 students there. And as I walked in through a door like that one, by eye, I could see the three other women in the room. And it was the first time I was like, huh, where are the women? And then I slowly started to understand that this was the norm, not Wellesley, but this was the norm. And eventually I began to not only understand it, but I began to see how it was affecting the women who were in that room. And I have to say, this was one of the many gifts Wellesley gave me. I never thought of myself as a barrier breaker or a freak for studying physics as a woman, you know? So that was the sort of the awakening. And yeah. From then on, I think my eyes were opened, and I still don't think of myself so much as a barrier breaker as just as someone who wants to right this wrong. So
I think you're a barrier breaker. Reshma, the gender gap in biotech is really glaring. You talked about that. Women earn
52% of PhDs in biology today, but only 23% are CEOs in the biotech industry. And I guess a much, much smaller number are women of color. What shaped your path, and what did you learn along the way that might help others?
Maybe to pick up on the thread that Nargis laid down, maybe I'm just dense, or maybe I just have my head down, but I didn't notice that there was path breaking and such going on. And I will say that I actually didn't know that I wanted to be a CEO, nor that it was within grasp. Full credit to mentors and others who saw it. And for me, my predecessor, Jeff Lyden, saw in me something I didn't see in myself. And if you ask, you know, when did you realize it? In July of 2019, we made the announcement. And we gave an exclusive to the Boston Globe. And it was actually in that interview, the day before the announcement was going to come out, I realized it, because the first question the reporter asked was, how do you feel that you're going to become the first woman CEO of a large biotech? And I thought, oh.
No pressure.
Yeah. Yeah. So what I want to convey is, while we have so much to do, there are much areas of progress, very visible areas of progress, and a lot of people like Representative Auchincloss and my predecessor who clearly can see talent where talent lies.
Thank you. And Dana, you moved from the U.S. to the U.S. from South Korea when you were a child. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit about how that experience shaped you and your desire to go into medicine, and kind of how you're thinking about that now?
Yeah, of course. So I immigrated here with my parents when I was 11, without speaking a word in English. And grew up in LA, in a small community, and I was actually the recipient of some of the programs that our lieutenant governor had described. So I went to a high school that was really dedicated for raising students who are interested in medicine and also science and STEM, and who were from disadvantaged communities in Boston, in LA. With that, I had many opportunities, going to the high school. Actually spent 2 summers in high school traveling to Philly and working in a bioscience lab and actually shadowing doctors, which were opportunities that I couldn't even fathom having, growing as an immigrant in LA in a small community. And that really prompted me to look at Wellesley and really venture out to a place far away from my parents and really to own this path on becoming a scientist and becoming hopefully a physician one day. And I remember this was the first day being introduced to Science Center, which was the old Science Center then, and it was during orientation, and there was a science fair that was being given by all the professors, and I went up to Professor Mark Tattel from Neuroscience and said, I really want to work in your lab. Can you let me work? And starting that day is when I got to work in his lab, and that really started my career in medicine, and I would really say that was complemented by the well-rounded education that I got at Wellesley. Having a women's and gender minors and taking classes related to health inequities really shaped my career in really focusing and shaping my career in medicine.
Thank you. Representative, you're one of the co-chairs of the Massachusetts STEM Advisory Council, along with Lieutenant Governor Polito, which is focused on enhancing STEM education in the Commonwealth and aligning economic and workforce development through employer partnerships.
and nationally, you're really a leader on this issue. I want to add, as you alluded to, that your mother, Dr. Lori Glimcher, is the president and CEO of Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and a leading immunologist and one of a relatively small number of women healthcare CEOs. And I want to say she was a very good colleague, wonderful colleague to have for so many years. What has her experience taught you?
Ruthless prioritization. My mom, and I've heard her, I almost can relay this verbatim because I've been with her so many times as people have asked her, especially young women, who have said, you know, I want to succeed in a high-paced career. I also want to have a family. And, you know, how do I make that work? And she always just says ruthless prioritization. She cared about two things. She cared about the quality of science that she was doing. The data had to be perfect. She cared about her children. And frankly, everything else took aside. My mom loves to garden. And every spring, she would plant a garden. And bless her, that garden died every single summer. It wasn't a priority. And I've taken that to heart. I got two little kids now. Teddy is 2.5, Grace is 1. My wife works full time. I'm traveling back and forth from DC to Boston. And we just have to be incredibly disciplined about what we say yes and no to and just recognize what's truly important in our lives. And that leads me to, I think, the best second big part, which is help for dependent care. I think that's one of the things that is really holding women back. Thank you. And I say dependent care quite intentionally because it's child care, yes, but it's also care for elders. By 2050, on our current trajectory, we're going to have 15 to 20 million Americans suffering from Alzheimer's or other neurodegenerative diseases. It's going to be women taking care of them, broadly speaking. I just think on the current path, we know that's going to be the case. We're going to have a sandwich generation of women who have kids and elderly loved ones, and it's just going to overwhelm them. We have so much work to do there. We've got to start investing at the federal, state, and nonprofit levels in a much better care economy. And my colleagues, Catherine Clark and Elizabeth Warren, really deserve the lion's share of credit for putting this issue front and center. Massachusetts has done great work at the state level, and I actually will say it was the business community that really stepped up there and said, this is actually a priority for us. But the federal government's behind, and we frankly didn't get it done this Congress, but it's going to remain a priority.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for your work in this area, and I will say Representative Clark is now our representative.
That's right.
But there's nothing, the pandemic just brought this home, and we already knew this, but the pandemic, I think, made this just so very, very clear about what is holding us back and the need for support for care. So thank you for your leadership. So I want to talk a little bit about what is it going to take to truly change the face of STEM to make it more inclusive. And each of you really brings a very different perspective to the topic. And Nurgis, you and I are both looking at this in terms of higher education and what we can do. And you know, at Wellesley, we've embraced the fact that if we want to be more diverse and inclusive, it's really not just a numbers game. Absolutely. It requires a complete transformation of the institution. And that's why we've put inclusive excellence really at the center of our new strategic plan. And I know it's a priority for you at MIT. So can you tell me a little bit about why you actually, what are some of the examples of what you're doing at MIT, both at the undergraduate and graduate levels, and in particularly in fields like computer science, engineering, and physics that are abysmally low, particularly for women of color?
Yeah, so it's a little bit different in the different fields, and so you have to look at where the breaking points are. So in computer science, for example, it turns out that the distinction between the number of men and women who go into computer science is to do with who has coded already as a teenager or a child. Yep. And predominantly, the boys have coded, and they come with a lot of coding experience, and the girls have done less. And so by the time they come to college, and then if you put them all in the same first year introduction to computing class, you will lose the women. Yeah. And so one of the successful experiments that have been done, actually was done at Harvey Mudd first, but is being propagated, is to have two separate entry-level computer science classes, not divided by gender, just divided by who's coded before and who hasn't. And then, at the end of the first year, you can bring them together again. In other fields where there has been more systematic setbacks, math is one, there you have to do a lot more. A year is not enough. So there you actually have to bring people on ramps that meet maybe after 2 years. But it is repairable. The sad thing is, it's what Reshma said earlier. By the time they get to college, the students get to college, it's so much harder to fix if we could only start earlier. And so I do think that we are doing what we can. And that's sort of on the academic side. And then there's this whole part about, which also Reshma touched on. You touched on every brilliant idea, can I just say? So is also representation of seeing role models. And so we're doing even worse at the faculty level. At the faculty level, you know, in fields where we have 50% of undergraduates get degrees in biology, for example, by the time you get to the faculty level, it's less than half of that. In something like physics, you know, a third of undergraduate degrees are to women. By the time you get to faculty, on average, about 12 to 15%, right? So you're losing people. So that's the other piece we have to build up. And to do that, we have to really start looking not at non-traditional places. We have a habit in academia of reproducing rather than renewing. And what I mean by that is we replicate ourselves. We hire the students we trained, rather than looking outside of our normal spheres and orbits and looking at who can bring really fresh new ideas. And so what if they don't think like us? That's precisely why they should come to our institutions. So that's sort of the range of things that I've been thinking about, how we operationalize that. We could be here for days and still not know if those are the best ideas out there.
Yeah, but, I love it. That is, reproducing ourselves. Yeah. And how do we break the cycle?
Right.
You know, you talked about what happens before college, and I'm going to turn to Representative Auchincloss. You know, Massachusetts really has the ability to be a leader in this area. We have strong public schools that are getting stronger, colleges and universities, and we are the national and global leader in the life sciences. What policy changes at the national and state level do you think we need as we think about more inclusive STEM?
We have to improve our math education. That's the foundation for the ST and the E. If we don't get math right, none of it can work. Mm-hmm. And probably the most demoralizing article I've read in 2022, and there's competition for that, is one that shows that we've probably lost 2 decades worth of progress in mathematics from 2 years during the pandemic. So one, we can't close the schools again if we have new waves of COVID, and we might, but we cannot close the schools because we did irrevocable, I think, or hopefully not irrevocable, but deep damage there. And we have to improve the quality of our math pedagogy. I think one way to do that, and this is controversial within my party, is expanding charter schools. We've seen that charter schools have been the vanguards of innovation in math curriculum. They've demonstrated ways to do one-on-one mastery tutoring of math in a way that district schools have not been as good at. And in Massachusetts, our schools are tied to our zip codes. That's how you fund them, is property taxes. And that means that the accident of where you're born has a lot to do with that K through third grade in particular education you're getting in math. And we know how much of the inflection point in the rest of your trajectory that has. So to me, expanding charter schools, letting parents and kids have more optionality with where they get an education, especially early in their lives, is really, it's about justice for these kids. And like I said, that there's reasonable and full-throated debate on that issue, but I feel pretty strongly about it.
And you know, I think your point about the pandemic and what it's done, the disparities there as well, not only are young
children and adolescents farther behind, but the disparity and how far they're behind has only deepened the disparities. So the work we have to do is really doubly intense, and we have to think about that at the college level as we look to recruit students to college. And how do we think about that and not reproduce kind of some of those disparities? Reshma, can you talk more about what Vertex is doing? Yeah. I visited Vertex not too long ago, and some of the work you're doing to grow the pipeline, I think, is truly just outstanding. Mm. Can you talk a little bit about that?
First thing to say is we do this work at Vertex to get a bigger pipeline because it's in our own self-interest. It's frankly selfish. This is not charity. I agree very much with what Nargis said. This is a lot about getting children at a younger age and making sure that they make it all the way through. So we have programs where we bring BPS students in at the elementary and middle school level, but we keep them there through high school. And the key that I've learned is you have to pay the interns. Otherwise, they have to go somewhere else and do a non-STEM internship. We in STEM love students. We don't love so much to pay our students. And we have to pay our high school students and our college students, and then we can keep them there. So that's one thing that we do. Another thing that we do is we have scrubbed all of our job descriptions because, and this is where data is important and studies are important. Studies show that when you have a list of criteria for what a person may need to apply for the job, men may think, I got kind of sort of 2 or 3 of the 12. And women think, gosh, I only have 11 of the 12. How would I ever? And so we have scrubbed our job descriptions and we've made it what you need to apply. So we don't weed anybody out. And the last thing I'll say is this point around childcare and parental care and making sure that our women have enough time to go and be pregnant and have children or take care of their parents or kids to do what they need to do. Corporations, companies, we have to make sure that there's enough time for that. I'll tell you, when I was pregnant, and I was pregnant with twins, so I was enormous, I was applying for my job at my previous company. And I was mortified about how I would go to this interview that pregnant, where I couldn't quite hide what was about to happen. And that meant I would be out of commission, in my mind, for 2 days, but probably for some number of months. And it wasn't Vertex. I was leaving Boston to go to a West Coast company. But the fact that they made me feel comfortable, and I remember what the hiring manager said. He said, we are hiring a stable of racehorses. They're all different. Some mature faster and some slower. Mm. And if you need more time after we hire you, it's just fine. And for me, it was a phew. And to have women succeed, we have to understand that these are parts and parcel of what we are and what we do and who we may want to be. And so I think that's a third thing that we do, and I think we do it reasonably well.
Well, congratulations. And you said something in there in terms of being told that you could do it at a different pace and that was a relief. I think we also have to share those stories with young women because they see each of you and they think you went from A to B and that it was a straight line without any issues and that you soared, quite frankly, from A to B. Mm-hmm. And that's not life. Mm-hmm. And we need to be able to nurture that as well. Dana, I'm going to take a different tact with you. You lead quality and safety for the emergency department at the Brigham, a place where I spent most of my medical career. Can you talk about how you bring an intersectional lens that includes gender, race, and social determinants of health to your work? You know, we know that the ED is oftentimes the first place where the pattern of care is determined.
Indeed. So, you know, I would say that our department really, as I mentioned, took a look inward to see what we're doing to examine how disparities are being perpetuated and also seeping into the care that we're providing in the emergency department setting. So one study that we did as a department and as an institution was, you know, looking at patients who are agitated and who are violent and who are being threat to themselves. And in that case, it is medically necessary for us to actually restrain them. So applying physical force to restrain them to a bed so we can provide the care that they need, medically and also psychiatrically. We saw a pattern in our data that black patients and our brown patients, brown men, are more likely to be restrained than white patients, which was shocking, but also not shocking to us. Thinking about the implicit bias and also the structural racism that are really playing a role in the care that we're providing, despite the best effort that we're putting into the care. So really, you know, my job comes down to, you know, looking at some of these disparities and really prioritizing health equity in the quality of care that they were providing. So right now we're leading a training program that is designed to train every single staff in our department so that they know how to use equity lens and also how to use trauma-informed lens when they're providing care. So thinking about the experience of the patients, the fear that they have when they are coming into the emergency department and considering that into the care that they're receiving, and also thinking about the threat of perception when we are also when we're caring for patients who are acutely agitated, and also thinking about the experiences that our patients are bringing to the emergency department. So thinking about the experience, prior experiences with racialized policing and how that might be impacting the care and how that's affecting our inability to de-escalate the patient. And also really thinking about how our patients might be experiencing care when they're being cared for by a team members that may not look like them. Yeah. So really all of that is what we're applying when we are thinking about the care that we're providing to our patients.
Well, you know, I mean, I think as each of you has spoken, it is so clear that if we don't think about how we're measuring whatever it is we're doing, whether it's looking at the job descriptions, the care, thinking about who are you recruiting to MIT, and representative thinking about just our policies, that it is so critical to bring that intersectional lens to all of it. My last question to each of you is really just going to be, I'm going to ask you to give advice to the young women here at Wellesley and everywhere. Since we're live streaming the event, what words of encouragement or inspiration would you give them? And I'll let whomever wants to go first to jump in.
Representative Auchincloss?
You better, right? I want to just build off what Reshma was saying about men overestimating or being very confident in our abilities and women. I cannot tell you how much I see that. I work in an environment with a lot of alphas, frankly, regardless, in the halls of Capitol Hill, but I just see it over and over again. And my wife and I talk about this a lot, actually. And so I guess my advice would be just be your own strongest advocate. The universe will bend to your will more than you think it will, but you have got to shout from the rooftops and put yourself forward.
Thank you. Shout from the rooftops. I love it.
I'll give you two quick ones. Get a mentor and take risks. Reward is indeed proportionate to risks.
Thank you.
So I personally have suffered from imposter syndrome. You know, I think that's so common, right, amongst women, especially as a woman in medicine and also an immigrant. And it is this, you know, irrational fear that you might be fraud, and that it is lucky that I got into Wellesley and that I got into Harvard Medical School. It was luck, right? And, you know, on the first day of our orientation at Harvard Medical School, our dean gave us a talk, And the first slide of the PowerPoint presentation said, "You belong here, you're not an imposter." And then I realized, wow, I'm not the only one who's feeling this way. It must be that, you know, all 150 of my classmates sitting in this auditorium must feel this way. So really, you know, I want to emphasize that every one of us, you know, has individual assets that are valuable and really take pride in that. And, you know, humility is good, but also you need to distinguish humility from fear. And, you know, I just want to also remind that you belong here, especially in STEM.
Thank you.
Good. Yeah, so I agree with everything that's been said, but I'm going to turn this around a little bit. I get asked quite often, what advice do I have for young women? And I want to turn around and say, I have advice for us old folks about what we should be doing for the young women out there. And I think really we should be thinking about who holds the power, what are the structures that are setting up the barriers that are in the way, and what can we do to remove those so that women, the younger women, can be their full selves without that having to be all on them to fix their conditions. We're the ones who set up this scaffolding in which they're existing. So it's on us.
Okay.
All of us.
Well, I just really want to thank each and every one of you for sharing. I think you're sharing your stories and sharing your expertise, your wisdom with us all. It will, taken together, I think we have a roadmap forward, and we just look forward to partnering with each of you. Reshma, thank you for a brilliant keynote address today. We are grateful. And Representative Auchincloss, as I said, we look forward to partnering with you, even if you're not our representative anymore. So right now, I'd like to invite members of the audience to follow me into the Farrell Focus, where we will have our poster session. Please wander around. Our brilliant students with the faculty will be at posters to share their science with you. You will also hear music from a group of our faculty who are fabulous musicians, and there's lots of food and drink. There'll be a short program out there once we get settled. So thank you again.